We are so excited. This is our first event for our International Education Week this week, and I can't imagine a better event. So Varshitha is a second year Harper student. She is co-president of Honors and PTK here on campus. And we are also very fortunate because she's going to be giving a presentation on Friday at a national conference over the same topic. So we are very fortunate that we're going to get a little sneak peek of what she's going to present over. It's Washington, D.C.?
Oh, it's in Dallas.
Dallas. Yeah. Sorry. So please give a warm welcome to Varshitha Akella.
Thank you so much for being here. As you know, this is a very important topic, and I'm so glad that you're here and letting me present it to you. Okay, so let's get started. The title is She a Prostitute or Is She Enslaved? I will reference that later, and I will clarify what I mean by prostitute versus enslavement. And I will be discussing sex trafficking in South Asia in depth. Okay, so what is sex trafficking? Sex trafficking is human trafficking, which is also known as modern slavery, for the purpose of sexual exploitation. And victims of sex trafficking are defined as people who engage in commercial sexual acts as the result of force, threats, fraud, coercion, or any combination of such means. And minors can be considered to be victims if they're involved in the commercial sex trade, even if they're not being forced to do it. So if a minor was to run away from home and engage in commercial sex voluntarily, they would still be considered being trafficked because they're not old enough to consent to have sex or have commercial sex. So victims are either forced into the trafficking industry or lured under false pretenses. And some of the examples that they're controlled through are given here, for example, violence, threats, lies, false promises, debt bondage, and manipulation. And yeah, I'll talk more about that later. So as I said, I would distinguish between sex trafficking and prostitution. Here in the Venn diagram, we can see that trafficking and prostitution have one thing in common, which is commercial sex. And trafficking victims and prostitutes both sell sex as a means of living. And one thing that trafficking, or people who are trafficked, have in their category is that pimps control the number of customers, the hours, the finances, and everything basically that makes their life is controlled by the pimp. And victims are forced to work every day and cannot exit the industry. So the number of customers that a trafficking victim would take per day is determined by the pimp. And they don't have bodily autonomy, and they're technically owned by pimps, hence the term modern slavery. And in prostitution, sex workers are in charge of their customers and how they choose to serve them, and the hours and the finances. So they're in charge of their life, and they're not under someone else's control. So they're able to quit the industry whenever they want. They're not under the threat to work even if they don't want to, and the worker has bodily autonomy. And one thing that I did want to point out here is that I know the prostitution bubble looks very nice and very simple. However, a lot of prostitutes were trafficked as minors. So the people that are in prostitution currently, or might get into prostitution as they age, they were trafficked into the sex trafficking industry by traffickers, and they were forced into the industry. So they keep using prostitution as a means to advance their careers because they don't know how to do anything else. And they're young, and they don't have a high school degree, they don't have a college degree, and that's all they know. And that's the industry that they're stuck in. So even if a prostitute is able to cover or is able to choose who they serve, the hours and the finances, they were still forced into it. 80% of people that are in the sex trade industry are forced into it as children. So it's very important to note that prostitution, even though it looks like a nice career where you can control your life, it doesn't always start out that way. All right, so we're gonna play a little game. Feel free to raise your hand and interact whenever you'd like. So here are some myths and realities that I've listed here. We don't know which one's a myth and we don't know which one's a reality. So the first one is most prostitutes voluntarily choose their profession. So if you'd like to guess whether that's a myth or not, please raise your hand. I will call on you. Yes, wait.
That's a myth?
Yes, you're right. And why do you think that's a myth?
I feel like a lot of it is involuntary because it's usually
Yeah, that makes sense. And like I said, 80% of victims of prostitution and trafficking are actually forced into the sex trade industry as children. So they don't really have a choice, and they don't know what they're going into when they go into prostitution. And we have seen that about 85% of people in the sex trade industry didn't know what they were going into when they first started it. So that's a myth. Right. And the second statement is traffickers don't always use physical violence. Is that a myth or is it reality?
Yes. Is it reality?
You're right. It is reality. There you go. Why do you think that's reality?
There could be false promises. Food could be withheld. That could be tactic, I guess.
Yes, you're right. So usually traffickers use more than just violence to lure their victims into the trafficking industry. Even when they are being trafficked, though, it's very possible that the trafficker make sure that the victim is under a lull. So for example, if someone's boyfriend is trafficking them, it's very possible that the victim doesn't even know that they're being trafficked, right? So it's entirely based on manipulation. It's an industry that's extremely dependent on being able to prey on people's emotional sides. Okay, so the third statement is traffickers only target people that they don't know. Do you think that's a myth or a reality? Yes, Emma?
I would say that's a myth.
You're right. So why do you think that's a myth?
I guess because it's easier to get someone in or convince them, like, hey, I know what's best for you, and then like you're really close as opposed to someone you might not know.
You're exactly right. So what traffickers do is establish a relationship of trust with the victim before they ask the victim to perform sexual acts for them or in a commercial sphere. So if a victim was to know someone, it would be easier for them to, you know, agree with them and go into the trafficking atmosphere. So even if a trafficker didn't know the person before, it's entirely likely that they're gonna make false promises or gain the victim's trust before they ask them to be part of the sex trade industry that they're propagating. And the next statement is only women and girls can be targeted as victims. That's a myth or a reality?
That's a myth.
Okay, thank you, Colin. You're right, that is a myth, and why do you think that's a myth?
Anyone can be trafficked.
You're right, yeah. That's a very subtle way of saying that everyone, including boys and queer youth, are trafficked, and 20% of the people that are trafficked worldwide are actually boys and queer youth. So it's important to note that while women and girls are the faces of sex trafficking, boys and queer youth are not, you know, excluded from it. And I will talk more about trafficking of boys in the context of some countries, because it happens more in some countries and not as much in others. Okay, so the last one is sex trafficking happens everywhere, including the US. Is that a myth or a reality? Yes.
Reality.
You're right. And why do you think that's reality?
Because it's a real thing that as you witness and read about, especially in Chicago.
Exactly. So my other paper, which I'm presenting in the National Conference, is actually about sex trafficking in Chicago and how to decrease it. So in Chicago, about 25,000 women are exploited in the sex trade industry every year. And you can ask more about that. You can ask me more about that later. But so it is reality that everywhere, even first world countries, experience sex trafficking, and it's a problem that's a worldwide issue. So sex trafficking around the world. So here are some statistics that I've listed to give you an idea of how many people are involved in this industry. So an estimated 6.3 million victims of sex trafficking are around the world at any given time. And 80% of sex trafficking victims are women and girls, and that's why I choose to title my presentation, Is She a Prostitute or a Slave? Because the majority of people who are in sex trafficking or victims of sex trafficking are women and girls. And 70% of the world's sex trafficking happens in the Asia-Pacific region, hence the focus on South Asia. And India is one of the largest countries, it's the second largest country by population, so there is a large amount of sex trafficking that happens in India. And the last one is that the average person trafficked for sex is a 13-year-old victim or 13-year-old girl from an impoverished community. And that doesn't surprise us because child sex is actually more popular in not only India, but many other countries in South Asia and around the world. And 13-year-old or young girls are prone to sex trafficking more than any other demographic. So here's a map. You can see here that's India and that's Pakistan, Nepal. These are the countries that consist of South Asia. And you can see that 1.1% of all of India's population, and India's population is 1.3 billion. So 1.1% of all of India's population is enslaved or has been enslaved, and that's about 100 million people. So this isn't in the context of sex trafficking itself. This is human trafficking, which includes labor, bondage, and blackmail, and other types of trafficking. So, and you can see that India, since it's the largest country, or it's second largest country in the world by population, and it has 1.1% of population that's enslaved, it's very important for us to focus on South Asian countries and make sure that they're getting the attention that they need. In Pakistan, here you can see that 1.2% of the population is enslaved, and Nepal is very red, so that's bad. Yeah, if you would like more information on that, you can ask me later. So sex trafficking in South Asia, I will be talking in the about the internal and the transnational sex trade. So internal is basically sex trade within the country itself, and most of the victims are trafficked domestically, so they're citizens of the country that they're being trafficked in. And the transnational sex trade means that victims are brought from other countries and trafficked as a result of being in the country that they're in, or even brought into the country for being trafficked. So India, it's the main country in South Asia that has the biggest population of victims. Here are some facts. So traffickers exploit domestic and foreign victims. As I said, domestic means someone who's a citizen of the country itself, and foreign victims are people who are brought into the country for the purpose of trafficking, or citizens of other countries who have found themselves in situations of trafficking. So internal trafficking of victims comes from every state in India. So no state is immune to the harms of sex trafficking, and victims come from every state. And that's important to note because people anywhere can be exploited for sex. And especially in India, that's true. And secondly, foreign victims come from Nepal, Bangladesh, Central Asia, Europe, and Africa. So there is a large sphere of transnational sex trade in India, and it's a hub for a lot of traffickers, and it's a destination, it's a transit place, and yeah, so there's a lot of that. Okay. So refugee populations from Rohingya and Sri Lanka are especially vulnerable because they're refugees, and they don't have proper documentation, so they can't present documents to local law enforcement authorities, so they can't, you know, ask for help even if they need it. And victims from India are sold into sex slavery in the Middle East, the Gulf, and Africa. And this especially happens when traffickers arrange fake marriages to get victims to go abroad. So it just so happens that in the Middle East, there's a high demand for domestic servitude and people who are, you know, can be exploited for sex trafficking. So traffickers arrange fake marriages, since the Middle East is considered a rich country or a rich area. It's very easy for people to be convinced that they can have a better life if they go fly to the Middle East, right? So traffickers exploit women and children to go marry some random person. Once they show up in whichever country they go to, they're sold into sex. And another interesting thing about India is that India is a source and a destination for child sex tourism. As we all know, that child sex is and child pornography is extremely popular, so India caters to that need very well. Okay. And the next country that's significant in this sphere is Pakistan. Traffickers exploit domestic and foreign victims, which is the same as India. And foreign victims, interestingly, come from Afghanistan and Iran, which are the bordering countries of India, as we've seen in the map. Or not India, Pakistan, as we've seen in the map. And children forced into bonded labor are sexually abused and tortured, which is, So the lack of government action against sex trafficking enables traffickers, and especially because the government chooses to ignore that there is trafficking happening, because the government doesn't acknowledge that as Pakistan is a Muslim state, and in the Muslim law, it's not sex trafficking, or not sex trafficking, but commercial sex isn't religious, right? So it's a bad thing, so they don't acknowledge it. And a lot of times, boys as young as six are lured into sex trafficking under the pretense of getting work in coal mines, and sometimes even parents are complicit and rent their children into the sex trade. Pakistani women and girls are sold into sex trafficking in Iran, Afghanistan, and China under the false pretense of marriage. So this is something similar we've seen in India, and Indian citizens were being sold to the Middle Eastern countries. However, here we see that Pakistani women and girls are sold to Iranians, Afghans, and Chinese people under the pretense of marriage. And once they show up to their country, once they show up to that country, they are sold into sex slavery. And boys bought from their parents are sold into sexual exploitation. So there is something unique about the exploitation that Pakistanis and Afghans use boys for. So it's called bachabazi. It's where boys are exploited into dancing sexually, or, you know, so they're exploited sexually, and it's especially for young boys, and usually it's men exploiting these children. And Nepal, traffickers exploit domestic and foreign victims. Nepali girls, boys, and transgender people are especially subjected to sex trafficking in the adult entertainment sector. So in the adult entertainment sector, I will talk more about that later. There are things like dancing bars and strip clubs, as we would call them in America. And a lot of Nepali girls, boys, and transgender people are forced into working there as part of sex trafficking. And foreign victims come from Afghanistan and Iran in Nepal. And although the Nepali people are more, they're more of a source than someone in, there's not a lot of people that go into Nepal as a result of trafficking, and there's a lot of people that go out of Nepal as a result of trafficking. So Nepali women and girls are exploited in Nepal, India, and the Middle East, and Malaysia, and other Asian countries in Sub-Saharan Africa. And India is especially a destination country for a lot of these women and girls. And Nepal's open border with India makes it easy for Nepali women to be trafficked into India. So a lot of times what happens is that these women are put into trucks and they're driven across the border. And the border patrol, or whoever is in charge of making sure that people aren't being trafficked, are bribed. So it just so happens that they profit from these women and girls being exploited. So yeah, and that's an issue that Nepal and India need to deal with. Traffickers take advantage of the relaxed screening systems in Indian, Sri Lankan, and airports to transport victims to destination countries like China and South Korea. So, as I say earlier, a lot of people are sold into sex slavery through the pretense of marriage. So what happens here in these cases is that in China and South Korea, there is someone waiting for these victims to come to their country, and then they're eventually sold into sex slavery. But the victims are told that they're being married off to someone who's rich and wealthy. Okay, in Bangladesh. So traffickers exploit domestic and foreign victims. Bangladeshi women are trafficked in illegal brothels and private hotels. One interesting thing about Bangladesh is that the sex trafficking industry in Bangladesh is very prevalent, even though prostitution there is legal and it's regulated. So I'll talk more about that later. An estimated 20,000 children grow up in brothels while being sexually exploited. So these children might be trafficked into Bangladesh, or they're Bangladeshi citizens who've been forced into a brothel. Or it could also be that these children are the children of prostitutes themselves. So they grow up around all of this abusive environment, and they eventually end up going into the sex trade themselves. And Rohingya women and girls are sold into sex slavery in Bangladesh, India, Malaysia, and Nepal. And they're also sometimes traded online. So the Rohingya is they're a stateless group, so they don't have a certain state that takes care of them, and they're considered refugees everywhere. So that makes them extremely vulnerable to traffickers, and they're easy to, no one cares about them, so they're easy to replace. Bangladeshi women and girls are trafficked in India, Pakistan, China, and the Middle East. As I said earlier, there's a lot of transit going on between Bangladesh, India, and Nepal, and it also seems that Bangladeshi victims are in the Middle East. Bangladeshi women and girls are forced into sex trafficking through arranged marriages. As I said earlier, that's a thing that happens. Traffickers falsify documents to make children seem older than 18 to send them to foreign countries. This is something we haven't seen before, and this happens in Bangladesh. So traffickers basically forge documents, and they send these children to foreign countries. And it also happens that the foreign people that are receiving these girls know that they're under 18. However, to escape the vision of the authorities, they actually forge documents. And there's a lot of demand for child prostitution, as I've stated earlier. And Bangladesh is also a destination for child sex tourism. Okay, so Afghanistan, since we all, as we all know, Afghanistan was put under the Taliban rule, and this is somehow related to that, but I don't want to address that right now. But internal trafficking in Afghanistan is extremely prevalent, and the boys are more vulnerable to trafficking than girls, especially in Bachabazi, as I, that's also a practice that happens in Pakistan, and apparently in Afghanistan as well. And some parents force their children into the sex trade, and government teachers, principals, and law enforcement have been known to ask sexual favors in return for doing their jobs or forcing young boys into sex trafficking. So young boys are extremely vulnerable to these law enforcement officials and government teachers, because in Pakistan or in Afghanistan, women aren't allowed to go out without a male companion. So these young boys who are allowed to go to school end up being sexually exploited by these law enforcement officials and teachers and principals. Bachabazi perpetrators consist of community elders, government officials, and the military. So the problem, it lies everywhere. And it's interesting because Afghanistan is an Islamic state, and in Islam, being homosexual is not religious, right? So it's interesting that a lot of these men prey on young boys. And after the Taliban takeover, the vulnerability of women and girls increased, so the likelihood of women and girls being trafficked also increased. Afghan women and girls seeking employment outside of Afghanistan are forced into sex slavery in Iran, Pakistan, and Europe. So these women and girls who are looking to escape Afghanistan because the conditions for them have been so bad, are sold into sex slavery in these countries, and Afghan women are sold to husbands in Afghanistan, Iran, Pakistan, India, and are forced into sex trafficking and domestic servitude. Nothing we haven't seen before. And economic hardships provide incentive for families to sell children to traffickers and marriages. So this is something that happens in Afghanistan because a lot of the population is poor, and they don't value children as much as they should. So what happens is that they sell their children because they want money, and then sometimes they even rent out their children so that they can keep making money off of their child sexual exploitation. And LGBTQIA+ individuals are not protected under the Islamic law, so are extremely vulnerable under the Taliban rule. So they're also trafficked as a result of being vulnerable. Okay, so I will talk about the types of sex trafficking, and these are the types of sex trafficking that are prevalent in Asia or South Asia. So the first one is pornography and red light. Okay, I will, you can, since you've looked at that, I will keep going and then I'll talk more about each topic in the slide. So pornography is when victims of trafficking are used to make pornography or pornographic materials, and the traffickers make money off of that material. And sometimes traffickers use pornographic photos or videos to blackmail the victim into submission and use them as normal victims of trafficking and not just pornographic victims. And child pornography is very popular, hence very prevalent in South Asian countries. Traffickers use social media sites like Facebook, Instagram. We're all on Instagram. They use these sites to make contact with children, and they either set up a meeting with the child or groom the child so that they self-generate pornographic content, send it to the trafficker. Red light districts are places where there's a string of brothels where people can go and solicit sex. So what happens is that these prostitutes, they come, people who are legally, or people who are voluntarily people who are voluntarily in prostitution come out of the brothels and try to entice these customers into the brothel. And once they go into the brothel, it ends up that a lot of people who are in the brothel themselves are children, and they're not being exposed to the outside world because sometimes in the countries it might be legal, but child sex is not legal. More than 2 million women and girls are trapped in red light districts in India. And some brothels are legal. So the red light districts are mainly where the brothels are legal and people know exactly what's happening in that area. Most foreign women and girls are held in illegal brothels by traffickers. They're called cage sex workers, and they're confined to brothels and forced to serve as many customers as the pimp requires them to. They're not allowed to leave the room. So that's why it's called a cage. And if they do leave the room, since they're a lot of times minors, they can go report to the law enforcement, which is basically useless. I will talk about that later. And Sonagachi in Kolkata is the largest red light district in Asia. It has a union that supports prostitutes' rights, which is somewhat functional, but not really. Sex trafficking is illegal, but still continues in India. So basically in India, prostitution is legal, however, sex trafficking is illegal. So the reason that, this is a picture of the union marching and advocating for the customers to use protection while having sex with the victims or the workers. So in India, it's legal to be a prostitute, however, it is not legal for someone to be trafficked. However, the reason it is legal is that the government chooses to ignore the fact that many people are being trafficked, and the fact that it is legal makes it easier for traffickers to exploit victims and paint them as someone who's in prostitution voluntarily rather than because they are being trafficked. Okay. In the adult entertainment sector, as I talked about this somewhat earlier, victims are exploited in dancing bars, massage parlors, strip clubs, and entertainment brothels. Victims start working in the sector as waitresses or otherwise, and then they're forced into commercial sex. And AES in South Asia is a source of tourism. So people go there to do that. Okay. And commercial surrogacy is another type of sex trafficking. This is actually very interesting because women and girls are trafficked to conceive and deliver babies. And in India, commercial surrogacy is illegal. So women can't make money by renting out their womb, even if they consent to it. So sometimes women are forced to sell their eggs by their families, and transnational surrogacy is actually illegal in India, as I said, which makes trafficking victims extremely valuable and more in demand. And here we see a picture of a child bride, who I will talk about. Selling of brides, which I've talked about earlier, is basically selling women and girls into sex slavery with or without their awareness. So women and girls are sold to men as brides. Their husbands, in turn, force them into sexual slavery. As many as 10,000 women and girls a year are forced into sexual slavery under the guise of being married. Women generally agree to marry the person. However, they are not aware that they are part of a transaction. And child brides are most vulnerable in sexual abuse and trafficking, and many of these child brides do not actually agree to marry the person. It's because their families force them into it, so they have no choice. Their families sometimes sell them to the husband as well. I put this here because I wanted to make sure that we saw the age difference. This is clearly a very old man, and this is probably a 7-year-old child, and I just wanted to point out that that is extremely common in India, and it continues to happen every day. Okay, so trafficking under the guise of religion. This is an interesting topic. So in India, there is a system called the Devadasi system. So in this system, Dalits are people who are of lower castes. Women and girls are ceremoniously married to a local temple deity, but in practice are used as sex slaves for higher caste villagers. Girls as young as 5 are dedicated to a goddess, and when they reach puberty, they are forced into ritual sex slavery. So basically what happens is that the parents believe, as I say here, Devadasis are thought to bring luck to a family, so the parents believe that dedicating their child to a god or a goddess can bring luck to their family, and they end up doing that when the girl is extremely young. And once they are dedicated into a life as a Devadasi, they are forced into sex slavery by the heads of the village, or sometimes they're broken in brothels and then passed around in the village as whoever wants them can have them, right? This is extremely prevalent in southern India. The picture here shows an ideal Devadasi. So in ancient India, Devadasis were extremely revered. Their purpose was to entertain royals and kings. And they used to be monogamous, and now it just so happens that we've exploited the system, so the patriarchy may win. So, all right. Methods of trafficking. So traffickers lure victims and women and girls into the sex trade by promising them work as domestic servants, Bollywood actresses sometimes, and other types of work, or making false promises of marriage. We've talked about that. They target women who are economically dependent or have very few relatives, so once they go missing, no one will miss them. Some traffickers kidnap children from public places. And this happens a lot in South Asia because public places are extremely crowded. So if a person goes missing, it's very likely that they will never be found. And the main goal is to separate the girl from a familiar environment. So once the girl is brought to an environment that is not something that she's familiar with, it's very easy to exploit the victim and make them do whatever the trafficker wants, because sometimes if the trafficker knows the person, they will trust them more if they're in an unfamiliar environment. Social media platforms, including Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok, are used to make contact. And once they gain control of the woman or child, they forcibly make them use drugs and make them dependent on the drugs themselves. So there have been some cases where victims have been rescued from brothels, but then they go back to the brothel because they don't have the drugs and they need the drugs. They're so addicted, they're forced to be so addicted that without the brothel itself, they can't function, and the brothel cannot function without them. So it's a codependent relationship, kind of. They're taken to a brothel to be broken in or raped by the trafficker. Usually what happens, and in a lot of accounts, the first time is generally the hardest for the person who has been trafficked. So once they're broken in, they kind of lose their emotions. And the use of steroids is also common to make the victim appear older, and they also bribe law enforcement to stay in business. That's why the law enforcement is very dysfunctional. Okay. This is a video. You can watch it.
After keeping us waiting for an hour, Mr. Khan emerges from the forest, and he isn't quite.
I should probably explain. This person is a trafficker, and Ross Kemp, who was an actor and an investigative journalist, he interviewed the trafficker. And it might be that this person's an actor and that they're filming it, but it's likely that the information that he's providing is extremely true, because we've seen from trafficker accounts that it is true.
Right. What I was expecting. He started his career as the bait in a honey trap, convincing young girls that he would marry them and then quickly selling them off once he'd got them into the cities. He now has over 75 traffickers working for him and is currently being investigated for over 25 different offences, but he has never been tried for any of his crimes.
I want to find out how many girls he's trafficked in the time that he's been a trafficker, and how long has he actually been a trafficker?
7 বছরে উঠান থেকে ওমন 200 টাকা লাগা থাকে না
খামনে
3-4000 মতো আর বেশি হবে তো না.
What would you look for to make the decision to traffic a particular person?
গরিব মেয়ে, মুসলিম সম্প্রদায়ের এবং আদিবাসী বা হিন্দু কিছু মেয়ে আছে.
How much does a girl go for when she's sold at auction? Maximum, we have been told by more than one source that you traffic girls as young as 9 years old. Is that true? If there's enough hue and cry created because they've gone missing, some girls you return to the community, is that true?
No.
Okay, well, we've been told the reason you don't bring girls back is that you kill them. Is that true? So you're saying that you do kill them, that they are killed?
তখন পুলিশ না খুঁজে পেলে তখন সিআইডি দপ্তরে তখন তোলবড় হয় তখন মেরে ফেলে দিয়ে আমরা.
So you kill girls. Do you have any idea how many?
Yeah, বলতে হিসাব তো করি না.
400. So he's saying that he's responsible for the death of at least 400 young girls.
Since we've seen that, that is the reality, the harsh reality. Let's move on. The impacts of trafficking on victims. So a lot of times trafficking victims contract sexually transmitted diseases and from customers, because customers don't use protection, and if customers are asked to use protection, the rate that they would pay to the pimp lowers. So. Yeah, and if the victim becomes too sick, they are released or killed, as we've seen in the video. And a lot of victims actually endure a lot of trauma and PTSD. They undergo a variety of mental illnesses, including anxiety, panic disorder, depression, substance abuse, and eating disorders. And a higher percentage of trafficking victims suffer from PTSD than war veterans. So, just to give you an idea. And they need to be rehabilitated into the real world, so they cannot function on their own once they're rescued from the brothel itself. They also experience stigma as a result of the stigma against sex trafficking in general, and their children also experience stigma. They can't go back to their families, and society shuns them because sex trafficking is so taboo, especially in South Asian countries. Can we watch this video? So this is an interview of some victims of sex trafficking.
Marbe kothay shudhu paer gaante. E gaante marbe, hater gaante marbe, ekhane marbe, ekhane marbe. Ha, ar e komore marbe, ar ekhane, ar ekhane. E chatte jaygay
So some communities view sex trafficking as necessary, even though it's extremely taboo. They know that it's happening and they want it to continue to happen. This is because they view sex workers as a necessity to maintain the chastity of higher class women. And some sex workers, or some also view that sex workers as a requirement to prevent rape and sexual assault of other women, and NGOs working to promote more progressive views are trying to help sex workers. However, these are some of the opinions that communities have expressed when asked about sex workers in general. So as you can see, there is very little regard to the experience of the sex workers themselves. So potential methods of mitigation. There are three main methods of mitigating sex work, or not sex work, but sex trafficking. The first one is abolition. Second one is legalization and decriminalization. I'll be talking about that. So the first one is abolition of prostitution. So basically, in abolition, all activities in the sex trade, including buying, pimping, and selling sex, would be illegal. They're implemented in Afghanistan, Bhutan, Nepal, and Pakistan. So all of these countries have completely outlawed any practice that is part of sex trafficking or even commercial sex. While all sex is commercial, or while all commercial sex is completely illegal, we still see a significant amount of sex trafficking in these countries. So clearly, abolition isn't working. And abolition punishes buyers, pimps, and prostitutes. So this causes the prostitutes to be disproportionately held accountable, and buyers and pimps are almost never convicted because everyone's so focused on convicting prostitutes who are the true victims. The legalization, so in legalization, all commercial sex except trafficking is legal, and variants are implemented in Bangladesh, India, and Sri Lanka. As I stated, in Bangladesh, prostitution is legal, and it is, it's regulated by the government. However, people are still being trafficked. So it's not successful in decreasing sex trafficking, and 90% of traffickers are acquitted, even though they have been convicted. So, this only makes it easier for law enforcement to turn a blind eye towards trafficking victims. So, if everything's legal, then might as well not care, right? Because they're not committing a crime, and it makes easier for traffickers to cover the victims and make them seem like volunteer prostitutes. Okay. So, neither buyers, pimps, nor prostitutes are punished. So this leads to predators enjoying zero accountability, and they can just roam the streets. The third third method is decriminalization of prostitution. In this method, so selling sex would be legal, but buying and pimping would be illegal. And this hasn't been implemented in any South Asian country so far, but has been successfully implemented in many European countries and New Zealand. Sex trafficking and the exploitation of women and children has been shown to significantly decrease when this method has been implemented. In the context of South Asia, though, it is kind of complicated because there are many factors that will lead to unsuccessful implementation in South Asia. This is because the governments are dysfunctional or extremely religious, so they wouldn't even consider decriminalization as an option. For example, the Taliban regime in Afghanistan discriminates against women and children, and decriminalization goes against the government's religion in Pakistan and Afghanistan. So they would never even consider it as a solution method. They would just choose to ignore it. And sometimes dysfunctional law enforcement also can be a factor that will lead to unsuccessful implementation. As I've stated before, police officers accept bribes and let the trafficking continue. And sometimes these bribes can also be in the form of sex work. And they don't respect the humanity of sex workers because there is a stigma attached to sex workers in general. And as I just said, deep-rooted stigma among the public against sex workers and victims will also cause governments to not consider decriminalization as an option. But if these factors are remediated, decriminalization might actually be a successful successful method to mitigate sex trafficking. Okay, so how can we help? There's not a lot we can do, unfortunately, but we can start within our country, and we can decriminalize prostitution in the US to set an example that this is where we stand. We stand with the victims and not the perpetrators. And we can raise awareness so more people are concerned by the issue, and we can also donate to NGOs that are working to help sex workers around the world. If you would like a list, please see me and I'll talk. Okay. And I will end with this quote by Barack Obama. "It ought to concern every person because it is a debasement of our common humanity. It ought to concern every community because it tears at our social fabric. It ought to concern every business because it distorts markets. It ought to concern every nation because it endangers public health and fuels violence and organized crime. I am talking about the injustice, the outrage of human trafficking, which must be called by its true name, modern slavery." So, yeah, that's it for today. If you have any questions,
sobering and very informative talk. Again, we do have some time for questions if folks would like to ask.
I have a question about the practice you said of renting out their children, which, I mean, I this is going to sound crude, but I can almost understand selling the child more than renting the child. Is the idea that the parents are functioning like pimps, or like, are they going to get the child back, and then, like, what is the thought on what's going to happen to the child? Are they going to be able to sort of get that child married off after having worked in the sex trade? What does it mean to rent your child?
So usually what happens is that the parents make a contract with the pimp.
I see.
And the parents don't usually see the pimp at all. Like, no, not the pimp, the child at all.
Oh,
like, they don't, once they rent out the child, mm-hmm. they know that the child exists.
Right.
But they don't, like, and then, like, I mean, as you asked, are they going to come back home? They're not going to come back home.
So it's like selling your child, but they call it renting.
Yes, okay. Yeah. It is renting because, I mean, I don't know, maybe they can get them back if they choose not to rent them anymore.
That's what's confusing.
Yeah, like that
to
seems
me.
Confusing.
Like,
but yeah, they get monthly installments of payment rather than one large sum.
I see. So,
yeah.
So it's about how you pay for the child as opposed to access to the child.
Yeah, you could say that. Yeah.
Wow.
Any other questions? So I was in Professor Tamajian's class, and she asked us to write a research paper on something in Chicago, and I picked sex trafficking because, I guess that's not how I came across the topic, because I was interested in advocacy against sex trafficking, against trafficking in general. I did a lot of research in sex trafficking in Chicago, and yeah, since this is International Education Week, I did a lot of research for South Asia. Yeah. Any other questions?
do think there's this interesting parallel, and just thinking about your Chicago paper with this, and that you know, I think for Chicago you made the argument that people see a typical Chicago prostitute as choosing that profession, as having gone into it as an adult, but in the majority of cases that's not true. And I think that even, so when you're talking about countries where it's legal and people think, well, this is, you know, she chose this, probably as an adult, I think that there's a really important parallel there to the international. And I think certainly significant to think about in terms of what's happening at home too.
Even when it is illegal, it's possible that people think that the prostitute chose that life for themselves.
Sure.
Because some people do. Because you're in poverty and you need like money, that could be like a viable source of income, right? But a lot of times people are forced into it either through their situation or because of someone else. And not because that's the life that they want for themselves. And I can't imagine anyone that would want that life for themselves. So, it's very uneducated to believe that prostitutes actually go into that fully knowing what they're going into. Yeah. Any other?
I have a question. In your research, you presented decriminalization as a potential improvement or resolution. Did you come across in your research on countries that are making good progress?
Yes, as I stated, countries in Europe, Sweden, Norway, France, they've all decriminalized, and even in like a year they saw a significant improvement in the statistics of sex trafficking, and especially in New Zealand they've seen that there's little to none sex trafficking in New Zealand. So if you decriminalize it, and basically what it does is just gives the power back to the victim, right? Because they have the power to go report to the authorities what's happening to them, and the authorities, if they are fully well educated, then they wouldn't judge them because they're the victims, right? So it's kind of like taking the power away from the perpetrators and giving it back to the victims.
Do you plan on presenting what you found about sex trafficking in Chicago?
Yes, that's the one I'm actually presenting in Dallas.
Costa Rica, I volunteer for an organization, the name is Fundación Tawa, and they are trying to help a lot of people from Central America and South America, because it happens a lot everywhere.
Sometimes
they offer a job, like, oh, do you want to be a mother?
Definitely possible that people are desensitized to it because of the word usage. If you know what trafficking is, then you know that it's modern slavery. However, when you call it trafficking, it just sounds different than slavery, right? So, and that's why we are trying so hard to associate the word slavery with trafficking, but it's still called trafficking. And you're right, it sounds different, so it must be different. That's what people
say. I have a question for you. So do you know if there are any kind of support services for people who have been able to escape trafficking that kind of help them?
There are organizations in South Asia that rehabilitate victims of sex trafficking. However, there's not enough, obviously, because the extent of sex trafficking is just so huge that not just one organization can cover all of them, but there are organizations that advocate for the abolition of sex trafficking and decriminalization and help these victims regain their footing. There's this one in Hyderabad. I'm from Hyderabad in India, so there's this one in Hyderabad called Prajwala. And they were started by actually a gang rape survivor, and she has successfully rehabilitated hundreds of sex trafficking victims in Hyderabad. So, yeah.
Hi,
you said like there are a lot of factors that contribute to like making it more difficult to like solve the problem and or at least like decrease the amount of sex trafficking that goes on in like South Asia and in like the entire world. And you mentioned too that a lot of populations that are more at risk are like minority populations, and like in the US a lot of people don't think about how like a lot of indigenous women are targeted by sex trafficking, and a lot of the people who are trafficked in South Asia are also minorities. Like in Afghanistan, I know like there are a lot of minorities that are trafficked, and like the government doesn't really do anything because they don't care about those minorities, or they're not as attentive to it because it's not a priority for them. So do you think a lot of the, do you think it's mostly NGOs that are stepping in to help? Because if it's difficult for, or not realistic for the governments to actually step up and do something about it, is like our best bet as like a global community to like solve this issue, would it be to like support these like independent organizations and donate to them?
That sounds like that's the solution that I can right now see, because you can't really control what a government is planning to implement in their country, right? So, and there's a lot of NGOs who's like, the victims are out of their reach. So it's even possible that there's thousands of, and even millions of victims who these NGOs can't reach, right? So as long as we can try as hard as we can to change the lives of at least like some people rather than like everyone, because obviously you can't fix the world alone. So yeah, you're right. And like, definitely that's like one of the ways that you can make an impact yourself and not trust the governments to solve the issue. And as you said, these governments don't really like pay attention. Most of the time, all they do is just change laws, and the implementation of the law itself is kind of overlooked. And that's where the problem lies, right? And like, if like abolition was truly implemented, then we wouldn't have sex trafficking or even prostitution in the first place. So it's the implementation of the laws where the NGOs come in.
I don't have this question like fully formed, so it seems like even the term sex trafficking seems to put the emphasis in terms of the criminal behavior on the people that are originally buying these girls, boys, and not on the end user, the person who winds up buying the sex at some point. And I'm just curious if you think like actually maybe we should be emphasizing, like, you know, we prosecute drug dealers, but it's,
people
sell drugs because people buy drugs,
yeah,
right?
Should
we be really focusing a lot more on like that sex tourism or like all of those different end user aspects of this?
Definitely. So decriminalization is basically prosecuting buyers and pimps.
Yeah.
So if we shift the rhetoric from focusing on people who are selling sex and people who are pimping, and in South Asia, pimping is actually a large crime and like it happens a lot. So I guess just by shifting the focus on pimps to buyers wouldn't help, but like shifting the focus from people who are selling to the pimps and the buyers as the people who are perpetrators and people who are in the wrong can help, I guess, decrease or change our viewpoint about prostitution in general. But yes, you're right that if there's no demand, then there wouldn't be a product, right? Yeah, definitely. And in Chicago, actually, there's 125,000 people buy sex, different people buy sex from the same 25,000 prostitutes every year. So, and a lot of the people that are arrested are prostitutes. About 95% are prostitutes that are arrested. So if you shift the blame from the prostitute because they're the victim and shift it towards the people who are buying sex or pimping, then yes, that would definitely help decrease the problem.
Like removing like the patriarchy
it's definitely, you're right that, well, you asked a question, but you're right in pointing out that we have to focus on the prevention aspect of it, because if someone falls prey to something and then they're healed, they're not fully healed, right? They still have, they still carry that trauma within them. So it's the best way for us to prevent sex trafficking, that the best way for us to decrease sex trafficking is by preventing sex trafficking. So yeah, you're right. And some of the ways that we can do that is by educating women and girls, especially minorities, because they're the ones that fall prey to these people. And a lot of times, even though perps kidnap victims, a lot of times the victims themselves they don't seek it out, but like they fall prey to these false pretenses that the perps set. So you're right that we should raise more awareness, definitely, and make sure that all of these people are well-educated and they don't, and kind of change the poverty scale and increase the standard of living, then definitely this will increase, yeah. Because the USA is a tier one nation, so there's not as much sex trafficking in the US as there is in like South Asia, right? And I guess that's kind of something that's like disproportionately represented, because I just said that yes, sex trafficking happens in the US as well, but it's significantly smaller of a scale than like other third world countries. So, yeah.
Hi, I just wanted to update comment here. It's because this is like such a great information or research, right? And so if there is something that you are doing to spread this information, for example, this kind of presentations, you know, to make people aware about this, because this is an issue. Have you thought about doing a project related to this?
I have, actually. That's kind of like my life's goal, to establish like an NGO. But next semester, I actually plan on working with local NGOs for my Global Scholar project. And that's with the Office of International Education. So yeah, and in the US, mostly prostitutes and victims of sex trafficking need legal aid. So I want to go to law school.
Cool.
But yeah, so I guess like I have kind of planned out my life around these things and make sure that like I do my part. So,
yeah. That's great.
Thank you.
I want to thank Varshitha again. Her presentation, and we will be posting it on the Office of International Education's YouTube channel. So if you would like to spread it to friends and share this information, you'll have the resource. If you're here for a class, we'll email it to your faculty members as well. Did anybody not sign in as well? Yeah, okay.
I'll bring
you. We'll get you to sign in. Thank you all for coming.
Probably next semester.